We have already been discussing function logs here and there for a while. Today we'll spend a bit more time covering this topic. But first, we are in debt to alarm management section and need to handle pumps and transmitter related alarms. The first situation we must detect is so-called dry running. This condition occurs when a pump operates without an adequate amount of fluid. If the pump runs in this condition for a while, it may lead to cavitation and critical damage to the pump's internals, such as the impeller, gears, casing, seals, or bearings. Let's implement that in code. First, retrieve the suction pressure value and create a dry run threshold variable in the persistent settings list. Then, compare the suction pressure value to the threshold. We want to generate a fault signal only when the pumps are ready to operate automatically. To achieve this, combine two auto signals using an OR operator and then combine the result with the comparison operation. During pump start-stop events, hydraulic system could experience spikes and dips of the pressure value. To address this, we will filter out the fault signal by passing it through an on-delay timer. For the timer preset, let's create the variable in the persistent settings list with the type set to time. Note how we assign the initial value to the variable. After T hash symbols, we can specify the value in milliseconds, seconds, minutes, hours, and days. Finally, we will create the variable in the alarm list and connect it to the queue output of the timer. Secondly, any centrifugal pump, when operating normally, creates a certain total head, or in other words, a specific pressure difference between the suction and discharge pipes. We need to detect a situation when the pump doesn't produce enough pressure, as this can be a symptom of a wide range of problems that might occur with the pump. Therefore, we bring the discharge and suction pressure to the diagram and subtract the second from the first. Compare that value against the threshold stored in the persistent list. Next, we want to detect faults only when the pump is running, as that's when the pressure difference is generated. So we bring in the contactor enable commands and logically add them. As in the previous case, we filter any possible disturbances by running them through a timer. Final point, we want to ensure this kind of problem does not resolve itself automatically. Operational staff should investigate and explicitly reset it. Therefore, we introduce latching functionality by adding an RS trigger from the standard library. Connect the timer and trigger together, then pass the output of the trigger to the newly created variable in the alarm list. Finally, to reset the alarms, let's use the auto switches, specifically turning it to the manual position. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is pump 1 fault detection. Now we just repeat the same for pump 2. Please also don't forget to add all the pump related faults we just created and the analog transmitter related faults to the global fault signal here at the bottom. By now you already know that pumps 1, 2 and pumps 3, 4 work as backups to each other in parallel. Since we are discussing pumps here, let's implement the pump switch function block. What do we want from that function block? It must receive a start input, two inputs indicating the readiness of the first and second pumps, and two outputs to give run commands to the first and second pumps. When a command comes to the start input and both pumps are ready, the pump different from the one that started last time must be started. If pump 1 was started last time, then now we must start pump 2. If only one pump is ready, we start it unconditionally. To balance the working time between pumps, we'll have a max run time input. So we create a function block PoU as usual and give it a name. This time I want to use ladder diagram as the implementation language. Declare inputs and outputs according to the specification. We start by bringing in a normal open contact and assigning it to the start input. Then add run P1 as a coil. Between the contact start and the coil run P1 will lie the logic that decides when the pump must be started. Let's cover the case when only pump 1 is ready. Add the contact ready P1, then ready P2 and invert it. The second case is when both pumps are ready and the last used pump was P2. We add a branch in parallel, contacts for pump readiness and then one more contact to indicate the last used pump. For that, we need to declare an internal variable. Okay, pump 1 logic is covered, now repeat the same for pump 2. Following that, we need to detect last used pump. At another rung, drag run P1 output as a contact and connect it to the coil last pump used. Next, change the contact to falling edge detection. This means that the ladder rung will be executed the moment the attached variable changes from true to false. The final step is to change the NO coil to the set coil. Now we just repeat the same process for pump 2 and change the coil type to reset. Good, we got it. But we still need to deal with pump alternation over time. Add another rung, then a T-on timer, which will measure how long the pump is running. Drag the rung P1 output to the in of the timer, then the max runtime variable to the PT input. Next, we could introduce another variable to indicate that the pump is running too long, but we'll achieve the same effect by using the last pump used variable. Place a set coil at the output of the timer for pump 1 and a reset coil for pump 2. By now a question might arise. Why can't we do the same with a function as we did before? And the problem lies in internal variables. Whenever you call a function, the PLC will create all declared variables and instances in memory, execute the function logic, pass the result to the outputs, and then purge all the data from memory. This means the last pump used variable will not retain its value, and timers will have no way to keep track of time because they will be recreated each cycle. Additionally, edge detection contacts can't be used, which is, to be honest, minor inconvenience. On the other hand, with the function block, you have to create an instance each time you use it, which means internal variables and function blocks will remain in memory permanently and retain their values from one call to the next one. I really hope this makes sense to you. Back to the function block. Everything would work as it is now, but as a developer, you should think, what if someone misuses my function block? For example, what if the max runtime is set to 12 milliseconds instead of 12 hours? Then we'd have contactors switching like crazy and eventually they would break down. So let's fix that issue. Add a greater than block in a series with NO contact and compare the max runtime set point with a minimum value, say 10 seconds. This way we can protect against too fast switching and, if needed, disable the switch over functionality entirely by setting this input value to less than 10 seconds. Great, now we have implemented the function block, let's put it to use. As a reminder, we have a water feeding subsystem, which consists of pumps 3 and 4 mounted in parallel. The main purpose of these pumps is to maintain a certain level of pressure inside the internal loop. In other words, whenever the suction pressure value drops below a certain level, we need to run one of the pumps until we reach the minimum pressure level. create a new feed-in subsystem program and for practice select FBD language. Although it is less flexible than CFC, I like how it produces clean, compressed code diagrams. First, create an instance of the PumpsSwitch function block. Attach the output variables that will control the contactors. Next, compare the suction pressure with the predefined variable from the persistent variable list. To avoid the system reacting to pressure dips, add a timer between the less than operator and the start input of the function block. The max runtime also comes from persistent settings variable list. Create two local pump ready variables, and on the next network below, we consider all conditions which make pump ready to run. Auto manual switch position and supply network fault signal, or inverted fault signal to be precise. Repeat the same for the second pump. There is one case when we want to prevent feeding pumps to run. It is a water leakage. Imagine if there is a broken pipe and water could leak from inner loop. Then feeding pumps would run without reaching desired pressure level. Because we don't have explicit leakage signal, we will try to avoid too big leakage by limiting maximum continuous pump runtime. Return to alarms management, bring pump running signals as inputs and run them through OR. Then add a timer to control how long the pumps are running. Create and bring feed pumps max time alarm. And the same way as with pumps alarms above, we want to latch alarm signal and reset it only when operator explicitly switch both pumps into manual mode. Once we have that ready, we ensure that when alarm appears, it blocks pumps 3 and 4 from starting.